بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. أما بعد. Very quickly before we begin, inshallah, the third درس in the lessons of some of the أحكام and the آداب of the masjid. Today during the خطبة الجمعة, we mentioned one of the reasons that the masjid was so important during the time of the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam is that it was the main place where people were educated about the religion. It was not humanly possible for the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam to be with every individual at that time. It's impossible, which is a proof against the understanding of al-hazir nazir. It doesn't make any sense. He couldn't be with everyone at that time. So the place of gathering was usually in the masjid and was a place of education. Today, we prayed the Salat of Jummah and we only made one taslim. We raised our voice and we said, Assalamu alaikum. There was not one person who came after the Salat to say, what was that about? Not a single person from our community. Now, I know there are some brothers from our community, especially from our students. I am muta'akkid jiddin jiddin, that they know that's from the sunnah. I know that. But I can't imagine that the vast majority of members of our community know that this is from the sunnah. As a matter of fact, I was told that some people in the back, when I said, assalamu alaikum, some of them made sajda to sahu because they thought it was a mistake. And they didn't know what was going on. But it just goes to show, Ikhwani, where our community is as it relates to not knowing, which is not necessarily a problem all the time. No one knows everything. But in terms of getting knowledge, our community has a problem. Our community has a problem. Today, our Imam, Zakatullah, he took a little longer in the last or in the second tashahud or the last one. He took a little longer. Than he normally does. Who goes to him to say, why did you take a little longer today? Maybe it's because he forgot, maybe he didn't know, or maybe he did that because it was something from the sunnah. So people who want to know the sunnah, this community, if we're really trying to be people who are loving the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam and trying to be on the sunnah, these things would at least cause us to ask questions. Not to allow the opportunity to pass us by without saying to the individual, why did you do that? Maybe it was because he forgot. Maybe it was because he made a mistake. You never know. But in being inquisitive, this is the way we're going to learn our religion. And that's what happened with the companions of the Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wa ala alihi wasallam. In this third lesson and darus about the masjid and the ahkam of the masjid, we want to start dealing with some of the issues connected to the masjid al-khas. The masjid that I told you in the first class, there are different masajid in al-Islam, like the masjid in your house, like the masjid, the two masjids of Mecca and Medina, or the masjid of Baytul Maqdis and so forth. The masjid on the tariq, the when you're driving, they're a masajid. And they all have their rules and regulations, what to do, what not to do, and how to get along with the ibadat and the worship of al-Islam in those masjids. So today we're going to deal with some of the ahkam, inshallah, of the masjid al-khas, the local masjid where people congregate in that place because it is centrally located or it's their regular community masjid. Going to start with the issue of entering into the masjid, and this is extremely important. You'll see it at every single prayer. Since we have to come to the masjid, we should know that the masjid is a place of nizam. Nizam. It's a place of nizam. It's not a place of folder, confusion, craziness. Our religion is not a religion of craziness. When you see our countries burnt to the ground and destroyed like that, al-Islam does not call to that, doesn't condone that. Something's going wrong when those things happen. The way people want to establish and practice Islam is not originally a religion of craziness. So for the revert, for the young person, for the old person, if you're practicing this religion, your religion, and around you, people are not really, it's just craziness. It's not from this deen. The salat in the masjid teaches us that. That the masjid and this religion is a place of nizam. Many proofs of that. Many. From them is what the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam said before he used to pray. لِيَلِيَنِي مِنْكُمْ أَحْلُ الْأَحْلَامُ وَالنُّهَى ثُمَ الَّذِينَ يَلُونَهُمْ ثُمَ الَّذِينَ يَلُونَهُمْ ثُمَ الَّذِينَ يَلُونَهُمْ وَإِيَّاكُمْ وَهِشَاتِ الْأَسْوَاقِ. Let those people, when it's time for the prayer, let those people stand behind me. Not any Amr, Bakr, Zaid. Let the people who stand behind me when I pray, let them be the elders from amongst you. The people who have knowledge, they know what they're doing. And then let the people get in and fill in after that and after that. He said, and beware of the hishat of the aswaq. Beware of the confusion of the marketplace. The confusion of the marketplace. If you go to the market there by that church in Birmingham, the guy is screaming out, another guy is screaming out, another one is screaming out. Men and women are going back and forth. People are throwing things. People are pushing their fruit all over the place. It's a place of folda, a place of folda, confusion. He said, beware of the confusion of the marketplace. That's a dalil that the masjid is a place of nizam. Not anybody should stand behind the imam. And when you come to the masjid and you start this issue of salat, beware of the confusion of the marketplace. We always have to deal with the confusion of the marketplace, especially after Salat al-Jumma. After Salat al-Jumma, the one imam in this masjid, Zakat Allah, he's really on the people concerning this throughout the course of the week. After the Salat of al-Jumma, people want to pray their 2 rakat, their 4 rakat. But the people in the masjid overwhelm the people who are praying with all of their kalam. And in almost every masjid, during the course of the day, this is the reality. You'll be hard-pressed to go into a masjid in Birmingham after the prayer. The people are not challenging. The people are praying. And the prayer, the masjid was made first and foremost for the people who are praying and not for the people to be talking like the marketplace. The hadith shows the masjid is a place of nizam. It's not the place of the souq. And that's why in that hadith we mentioned that the most beloved places to Allah are the masjid. In that same hadith, he said, وَأَبْغَضُ الْبِلَادِ لَلَّهِ أَسْوَاقُهَا. And the places that Allah hates the most are the marketplaces because of the confusion that's in the marketplace. From what shows, the masjid is a place of nizam. It's a place of system. Don't come here the way you want to come. Don't be here the way you want to be. You have to have do's and don'ts that you have to be aware of. Is that the Prophet told us, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِنَّمَا جُؤِلَ الْإِمَامِ لِيُؤْتَمَّ بِهِ فَإِذَا رَكَعَ فَارْكَعُوا وَإِذَا رَفَعَ فَارْفَعُوا وَإِذَا صَلَّى جَالِسًا فَصَلُّوا جُلُوسًا. The imam has been made to be followed. So if he bends down, you bend down. And when he get up, you get up. And if he prays sitting down, you pray sitting down. You have to follow the imam. When you come to the imam, to the masjid, you can't do what you want to do. That's the point here. Something is going on in the masjid that you don't like. You can't make the izala of that munkar, in your opinion, the way you want to. That's the point. And there are many, many proofs, but we don't have another time. He mentioned sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam, don't precede me in the prayer. Don't go down before me. Don't get up before me. All of those hadith are concerning the issue that the masjid and the salat to be done in it is a place of nizam, a place of a system. Now when we see the masjid, we're at the end of time, as the Prophet mentioned sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, إِنَّ مِنْ أَشْرَاطِ السَّاعَةِ أَنْ يَمُرَّ الرَّجُلُ بِالْمَسْجِدِ فَلَا يُصَلِّي فِيهِ رَكَعْتَيْنِ وَأَنْ لَا يُسَلِّمَ إِلَّا عَلَى مَنْ يَعْرِفُهُ. From the signs that the hour is here, is that people will come in the masjid and through the masjid, and they won't pray two rakats. And they'll only give salams to the people who they know. Where during the time of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as you're going to see, one of the important issues of the masjid is when you come in, the issue of the salams. But anyway, how many people do we know? They come to the masjid and they have some issue inside of the office because they're marital problems, or he needs a piece of paper, or he wants to ask a question, or he wants to pay zakat, or whatever. He walks right through the masjid, and he'll go to the office, and he'll come back, and he'll leave. That's one of the signs of Yawmul Qiyamah. That's the masjid today. The person wants to cut through the masjid and take a shortcut. So he may come through this door if it's open, and he'll walk out to get to that door in order to go to Morrison's. And he doesn't pray two rakat. Something brings him to the masjid, and when he comes, he doesn't feel, I'm in the masjid, I should pray. It's not wajib, but I should pray. That was what the companions were upon Ridwanullahi alayhim. If one of them entered into the masjid, I don't say it's wajib, and you have to pray. But the masjid is something in the mind of the person, in the heart of the Muslim. I'm here, I have to pray. I can't come and sit in the parking lot, for an example. I'm going to wait 30 minutes until my wife goes in and comes out from Morrison's, for an example. Someone comes in and uses the toilet, akramakumullah, and he goes out. The person has the time, the wherewithal, and the ability. He's trying to make salat in the masjid. Don't be a person who comes in the masjid, you walk through it, and you don't pray. Also, you don't give salams except to the people who you know. That's it. And as I said, we're going to deal with that issue, inshallah, because it also is an important issue. But that, I think, is kind of small in comparison to what we also find. Yes, there are those people who go through the office, the masjid to the office, and they sit, and then they come back and go out. It's from the signs of the hour. But worse than that is how we see some of the masjids in the Muslim world here in Birmingham, wallahi, saw with my own eyes last Sunday that just passed. Is the dancing that goes on in the masjid under the name of ibadah, it's worship. There are people who make dhikr of Allah and they're doing all kinds of things and spinning around in the masjid. That's not what the masjid was built for. That's not what the companions knew were part of the masjid that the Prophet was on, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And in the places where we come from, Pakistan, Bangladesh, many parts of Africa, where we come from, the Arab world is even worse than that. And that is the dead bodies that are buried in the masajid. There are masajid in Somalia, masajid in Egypt, in Tunis, in Morocco, Algeria, many parts of the Muslim world. There are dead bodies buried in the masjid. And the people use the Quran to prove this from the deen. قَالَ الَّذِينَ غَلَبُوا عَلَىٰ أَمْرِهِمْ لَنَتَّخِذَنَّ عَنْ مَسْجِدًا. In Surah Al-Kahf, when they were discussing about the people of the Kahf, some of them were saying this, some of them were saying that. And the ones who won the discussion, they said, we're going to build a masjid over these people. So the Muslims say it's permissible to build a masjid over someone who's dead and to bury them in the masjid. I saw many masjids like that in India, many masjids with my own eyes. So all of that, we say, what is that? What is that masjid? So from the Ahkam, Ikhwani, as we mentioned, and I'm going to go really slow here because what's important is for us to practice this. And many of us know some of this, but we forget because we don't consider its importance. Coming into the masjid, there are a few things we need to do. Number one, everybody came into this masjid who's sitting here right now. No one popped up in this masjid like that. We all came in. But did we all do what we know is from the etiquette and the ahkam of coming into the masjid where we just came in? And this was something the Prophet put a lot of emphasis on, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When you come into the masjid, there are three things I can remind you of doing. Number one is that you should come into the masjid with your right foot. You should come into the masjid with your right foot. In our class on Tuesday, the shama'il of the Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what he wore, how was his beard, how tall was he? What did he eat? How did he sleep? How was his shoes? All of those details about him so that we'll know the one who we are trying to follow to the best of our ability, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam. Our mother Aisha described him and she said he used to love using the right in all of his affairs, combing his hair, putting his shoes on, making his tahor, his wudu, his ghusl. So in whatever is from azina and beautification, and whatever is from virtues, what you're using your hands, eating, drinking, whatever is from what is nasty and dirty, you're going to use your left hand. It was his sunnah to start with the right. So he used to go into the masjid with his right foot. He used to put his shoes on, starting with his right foot. We mentioned to the brothers the other day, and I want to mention it again because in this dars is going to come up as an important example of the fiqh of the sheikh. A sheikh ibn Baz, Abdulaziz ibn Baz, rahmatullahi alayhi, was asked a question. I know that the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, in an authentic hadith, no one should walk with one shoe on and one shoe off because shaitan does that. The person said, what if my shoe is only one or two steps away? Can I put one shoe on and walk to the other one? He said, in istata'ta an la tukhalif as sunnah bi khutwatin wahidin bi khutwatin wahidatin faf'al. If you have the ability not to go against the sunnah in one step, then don't go against the sunnah in one step. Don't oppose the sunnah in one step. You'll see why I mentioned that, inshallah. When we come into the masjid, there's two doors that we have to come in now as a result of the construction. And even without the construction, we have to come through two doors. The first door is right there on the street, Little Green Lane, and then the next door is right there where you actually come into the masjid. Should I come in the first door with my right foot and the second door with my right foot, or is the emphasis on the second door where I'm actually coming into the masjid? Go into both doors with your right foot and you will be free from any blame. Go through both doors with your right foot, you'll be free from any blame. Second thing, coming into the masjid is the dua. This is critical because we forget, although we know. The Prophet told the people, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, if anyone goes into the masjid, then let him say, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. It's one of the many places where we should say, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Like on Friday, you should say that more. Before making a dua, you should say that. In your tashahud, you should say that. When you come together and you start an assembly, like when you go to school, you go to work, as soon as you sit down, he said, if someone comes and he sits and he doesn't say sallallahu alayhi wasallam on me at that sitting, is going to come as a sorrow, as a cause of his sorrow, yawm al-qiyamah. If you come into the masjid, he said, if anyone comes to the masjid, say sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and then let him make the easy dua, Allahumma inni as'aluka abwaab rahmatik. Ask you for your rahmah, from the doors of your rahmah. There are other dua, that's the easy one. As'alallah al-azim, biwajhihi al-kareem, wa sultani al-qadeem. That hadith, you can make whatever you want, but make that dua. So come in with the right foot and do that. And number three and the last thing, relax and take it easy. Relax and take it easy. Today, coming into the masjid, making wudu, the imam was reading, the people were hurrying. How many times the person is in the parking lot, in the car park, and we start to hurry because we know that we're late. When you're in the masjid in this walkway right now, your nafs, your hawa, it naturally tells you, hurry up, hurry up, hurry up. And you start hurrying. But the religion doesn't want that from you. The Prophet says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِذَا أَتَيْتُمْ إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ, if you people came to the prayer, فَمَا أَدْرَكْتُمْ فَصَلُّوهُ وَمَا فَاتَكُمْ فَتِمُّوهُ, if you come to the prayer, فَعَلَيْكُمْ بِالسَّكِينَ وَالْوَقَارِ, slow down and take it easy and relax. And there's a reason behind this hadith. He prayed and two men came in. Some men came in and they were hurrying. He prayed and he heard that noise. He said to them, what caused you people to do that? They said, we wanted to hurry up to the prayer. He said, if you come to the prayer, then take your time. Be relaxed. Take it easy. Don't rush. Whatever you catch, you caught it. And whatever you miss, get up and make it up. So those steps of being in a hurry, try not to go against the sunnah, even in one step. That is a sunnah that everybody here naturally is something that's inside of us. وَخُرِقَ الْإِنسَانُ عَجُولًا. Mankind has been created in haste. He wants it right now. So even the one who has knowledge and the one who's trying to practice, if he's walking through that walkway and the adhan is going off, there's something inside of us that naturally makes us hurry up. Just walk naturally. I repeat, walk naturally. Don't go to the other extreme of that guy who hears what I'm saying and then he really slows it down. And then he walks very slow. By the time he gets there, the salat is over because he walks so slow. And then he says, Abu Usama said this from the sunnah. That's not from the sunnah. Just walk naturally, not too slow, just your natural way. And then there is this issue of, if the people go into rukur and you're right there where you're about to turn the corner, then you say Allahu Akbar and you go into rukur. And you just keep walking in rukur until you can get to the saf. And if they raise up, Sami Allah, liman hamida, you raise up. And you keep walking until you get to the saf. And then by that time, at some point, you'll catch that imam if you do it from this base right here. And that's what is established from the companions of the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. People who don't know, they get upset. They say, what is this? What is that? Just because you don't know, don't get upset. Don't get wild. Relax yourself and pump your brakes. He doesn't know that the salam, assalamu alaikum, is from the sunnah. He doesn't know that. So he gets upset. And then instead of coming to you, asking you, why? Where is it? Let me see it. So as the Arabs say, man jahala shay'a adahu. Adahu. Anyone who is ignorant about something, he takes it as an enemy, as animosity towards it, because he doesn't know. He doesn't know. So those are the three things that we advise, akhwani, concerning coming into the masjid. The Muslim comes into the masjid with his right foot. He makes two sets of dua, durood al-sharif, on the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam all the time. And also, he asks Allah azza wa jalla to open up for him the doors of his rahmah. And he comes to the masjid in an easy, soft, calm way. Next issue is the issue of greeting the masjid. The tahiyyatul masjid. We have mentioned this many times and will continue to mention it many times, inshallah, in trying to bring the knowledge and the realization of the importance of this haq of the masjid. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam, he was sitting with a group of his companions and a man came into the masjid and he sat down. Rasulullah said, why did you sit down without praying two rak'ats? The man said, I saw you sitting down and I saw your companions sitting down. So I came and I sat down. A, it's the natural thing to do. I didn't do it for any reason. I'm not trying to disobey Allah and His messenger. I'm not trying to be a bad person. I saw you sitting, they were sitting, I came and I sat down. He told the people, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that man and the people, إِذَا دَخَلَ أَهَدُكُمُ الْمَسْجِدَ فَلَا يَجْرِسْ حَتَّى يُسَلِّيَ رَكَعْتَيْنِ. If any of you, he told the people, if any of you enters into the masjid, then don't sit down until you pray two rak'ats. He said that to the people there, and he said that to us because they transmitted that to us. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa radiyallahu anhum ajma'in. So therefore, ikhwani, any masjid that you go into in the dunya, if it is a masjid where there's five prayers and the Jummah is being performed, and it is that type of masjid, then you shouldn't sit down until you pray two rak'ats. If you have sat down in this masjid without praying two rak'ats, then you're going against the sunnah and the command and the prohibition of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam. And how many people don't know that this is from the most important etiquettes of the masjid, that you're not allowed to sit down until you pray these two rak'at? The average person from this ummah doesn't know this hadith. doesn't know this hukum. So for that reason, some of the scholars of Islam of the opinion that the greeting of the masjid, those two rakat, it is from the prayers that are wajib upon us. And some people take a different opinion. As for the person who comes into the masjid at Fajr time, when the sun is going to be at its zenith, when the sun is about to set, then if he prays two rakats at that time, he's doing something that is disliked. It's makruh. And the thing that is makruh is that thing, if a person leaves it, he'll get rewarded. And if he does it, he's not sinning. And he's not sinning because he does have a hadith that told him, if you come into the masjid, pray two rakat. So he's listening to the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And when you listen to the Nabi, no one can blame you. But when you listen to him without fiqh, you may put yourself in a bit of a pickle. So the fiqh of the issue is, there are a hadith that say, we shouldn't pray at those three times. When the sun rises, when it's at its zenith in the middle of the day, and when it's setting. Don't pray at those times because a shaitan, he bows at that time. The people worship as shaitan. This is a time of prayer for them, worshiping the sun and the fire. So don't pray at that time. And the other hadith said, come into the masjid, pray when you come into the masjid. Then just stand up until you know that the sun has set. If you know that the sun has set from the adhan, then pray. If there was no adhan, but you knew the sun set, you can pray. If you knew that the sun came up and it's the time for the sun coming up, then you pray and so forth and so on. But when you come into the masjid, generally you should pray the tahiyatul masjid. Also, ikhwani, from the really important ahkam of the masjid, is that when you come into the masjid, there is no salat to be prayed once the adhan has been made, except the salat of the adhan. So when the imam starts to pray the dhuhr and the maghrib or the isha prayer, because the muadhin made the adhan, when that muadhin or someone makes the iqama, every other salat is impermissible to pray. You cannot come into the masjid and pray the two rakat of al-jum'ah when the wajib prayer has started. Now I know and understand that the Hanafi people are on this opinion. They have some great scholars who took this opinion. From them, the great scholar who wrote that book, Sharh Ma'ani al-Athar, al-Imam al-Tahawi, Abu Ja'far al-Tahawi. He has the Aqidah book, al-Aqidah al-Tahawiyah. He's Hanafi from al-Hadith. He has a good Aqidah book. And he was a good imam of Islam. He went where the hadith took him. And he wasn't muta'assib to the madhab. Whatever the hadith said, he would take that against the madhab. But he was a mujtahid, and he's a human being, and he made mistakes like everybody else makes mistakes, but he's a great scholar. He brings some athar from the tabi'een, some athar from the companions in that book, showing how it is permissible to go off on the side and pray those two rakat. But that hadith, when it stands against what the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, those athar, and they're there. And that's the best research that they have in this issue. Those hadith, those athar are there. But the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, إِذَا أُقِيمَتْ الصَّلَاةُ فَلَا صَلَاةَ إِلَّا الْمَكْتُوبَةُ. If the iqama and the adhan goes off, and it's time for the salat in the iqamah, then there's no salat except that one. You can't go and pray anything else. You have to come and pray with the people. So that is as it relates to the people who enter into the masjid. Also, coming into the masjid, there are two issues we have to touch upon from the etiquette of the masjid, and that is something that happens on Jummah a lot and something that happens throughout the normal week, especially in masajid that are cultural. And that is at-takhatti dar-rukab, splitting the people who are sitting there. Now, in this portion of this class, I'm going to speak on behalf of a few people. I'm going to speak on behalf of people from the community. So don't hold me responsible. I want those people to finally feel someone is addressing some of this stuff that's going on in our masjid and in other masajid. So I'm speaking on their behalf. One of the things that's not permissible is to disturb people when they're in the masjid by splitting them. A man, he did that. And the Prophet told them, if you come to the masjid, don't do that. But instead, say to the people, ifsahu, ifsahu. Open up the way, make a way. So if you come on Friday, before the imam is praying and is jam-packed, and you come through, and even if it's not jam-packed, but people are there, you say to them, open up the way. Ifsahu, no problem. But do your best not to split people, because a man did that during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He came and he split the people. He said, "Laqad adhayta," you have bothered the people. You annoy the people. The man is sitting there reading. He's making dhikr. He's contemplating. He's just there. And you come and you start moving him. You shock him and so forth and so on. So do your best not to do that. Another issue is, he prohibited us from sitting in a special place in the masjid the way the camels sit in a special place in the masjid. Meaning, a person saves an area for himself and he only prays in that place. And only he has the right to pray there. Like in the first row, in some places, in some masajid, you have people who put their prayer rug there, they put their kufi there, they put their cane, their chair, something is there. And you can't pray there. It may be in the corner. So when he comes and he sees you, he starts to go, and he expects you to get up. If you don't get up, he'll say, "Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi rajiun. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah." The youngsters have no respect. The Prophet says, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam, لَا يُقِيمَنَّ أَحَدَكُمْ أَخَاهُ يَوْمُ الْجُمْعَةِ ثُمَّ يُخَالِفُ إِلَى مَقْعَدِهِ وَلَكِنْ يَقُولْ إِفْسَهُ. Don't allow any of you people to come on the day of Jum'ah or any other day and cause your brother, get up from this place. You get up and move so that I can get there. And then he plays in his praise. He said, instead, say to the person, to the people, إِفْسَهُ. Make room for me so that I can pray. But if the imam is giving the khutbah, then don't do that. As it relates to sitting and praying in the same place, then there's an authentic hadith about the impermissibility of that. He said, do not. He prohibited the people from getting in that one single place, and you're praying in that place all the time. Whether you save the place or you always make it your business to go to that place, even if it's empty. The more places that you pray in the masjid, the more places of the earth that will come and bear witness for you, Yawmul Qiyamah, because the earth is going to bear witness what we did on the top of the earth. He prayed here, he prayed there, he prayed there, he prayed here, he did this, he did that, as opposed to, he did this over here, that was haram. She did that over there, that was haram, and so forth and so on. So don't pray in the same place in a masjid, and don't cause people to get up. The last issue, and I'm speaking on behalf of people from our community. First thing at the top of the list is the issue of the last issue is the issue of a tashwish. Tashwish is the noise and the unnecessary chaos that goes on in the masjid. Tashwish is what normally bothers people, the noise and the chaos. First thing that we want to mention, but we won't go into detail because there are going to be some classes specifically for this, inshallah, the telephones, the mobile phones. You are not going to pray in too many masjids where the phone is not going to go off in that masjid. I go further and I'll say, there's a phone in each row that's going to go off at some point. And one of the disturbing things is that the people are calling us or our wives who know this Salat time and he went to the masjid. And they call you at that time. So the person forgets to cut his phone off. We're going to deal with the fiqh of the mobile phone, multiple classes by multiple people. Inshallah, is going to come pretty soon. I know some people from the ulama of Islam who, if the phone goes off in their majlis, like it happened with the sheikh we were with, Sali bin Abdullah al-Usaymi, there in al-Medina. Because the majlis of the knowledge is so important, Quran and the Sunnah, there are certain things you have to have edep. This is not the place for confusion and disrespect to the Quran and the Sunnah. The phone goes off, you'll say to someone, hey, what are you doing? Turn your phone off, please. And then after that, someone else's phone goes off and he gets upset. Someone else's phone goes off, he gets up and he leaves. And leave the people just right there. Those students who love knowledge and those students who love him and they love the circles of knowledge, they hurt because they say, this is how the ummah is when it comes to learning about knowledge. Knowledge which will give you life. The regular person from the ummah, he says, but this sheikh is too rough and too tough. Although the people of the salaf used to do things like this. If you came to the majlis and they were talking and they weren't paying attention, the sheikh would get up and leave and let the people know, you're not serious students. The companions were people who, when the Prophet started talking, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they described themselves, they sat so still that if the bird came down on them, the birds can sit there because that's how they respected revelation. Today, he sits with his feet like that. Another one is over there eating raw onions, throwing garlic to the other brother. This one over there is chewing bubble gum and blowing bubbles. And that's how it is. So the teacher, he has to relax. He has to know his environment. Over there, Sheikh has some serious students. So he can do that and they'll learn. But over here, you can't be like that with the people, because if you were like that with the people, it's not the environment. We have an environment that's not like that. You have to take it easy with the people. So the point here, Ikhwani, is telephone is a fitna. Right after the man says, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, instead of getting busy with adhkar, al-adhkar takes his phone out to see who texts him and who he has to text back, even if he didn't get a call. That's just the way it is. It's the life that we're living. But we're going to leave that discussion for another day, inshallah. Tashweesh. I was praying in the masjid. Someone had a ringtone of a song a few years ago where the guy was saying some offensive things. When he was saying, I ain't calling you a gold digger, but you're some other nigga. And we were hearing that with the music going on in the masjid while we were praying. I couldn't believe it. I could not believe it. And it was going off. And the person doesn't have fiqh. He doesn't realize, hey man, put your hand in your pocket and stop that. He doesn't realize that. And through the prayer, that song was going off. I don't think anybody had prayer on that day. Mobile phone. Indian music, Arabic music, hip hop. Comes to the masjid and disturbs us. That's from the tashweesh. I want to speak on behalf of some of the sisters who have to deal with children who are running in the masjid like they're maniacs. I don't want to be stereotypical and I don't want to be racist or anything like that, but for the most part, African-American parents, Afro-Caribbean parents, some parents from Algeria, Morocco, here and there, Africans, when their kids get crazy, they just do certain signs. And the child gets with the program. Some of you people, the kid is walking and running up and down the aisles, grabbing the women's niqabs, grabbing the auntie's glasses, running up and down, screaming and playing. And then the other ones get involved. And no mother says, hey. They destroy the Jummah. It makes people say, I'm not even coming to the Jummah in the masjid. And you'll find that in many masjids. Those women who don't know how to sit their children down and calm their children down at the time of the Jummah. And it's an ongoing issue. Ongoing. Don't bring your child to the masjid when they're like that. The masjid is not for them at that time. Go to Morrison's. They sell food in Morrison's. And some of it you can eat. Go and spend that time in Morrison's. And let the other sisters listen to the khutbah. The lectures. They're not as bad as Salatul Jummah. Although the lectures are the same way. Why bring your child to the lecture and you can't get them under control? Why would you do that? So many other sisters, they can't say anything because you don't want trouble. But I say from here, those women and their husbands, don't come to the masjid. The masjid is not for that. The child can come to the masjid and they can make noise like we heard just now. They were making noise, but they were not compromising the lesson to that degree. As for what goes on upstairs, it is haram and it's not permissible. The mother is sinning. The father is sinning. Don't bring them to the masjid. The other issue of at-tashwish, and I'm speaking on behalf of members of the community, are those people who the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was praying and he heard some people come in and they went down on their knees and they made noise when they came in. He said sallallahu alaihi wasallam, إذا سجد أحدكم فلا يبرك كما يبرك البعير. If one of you goes to make sajda, they were behind him, he said, don't make sajda the way the camels go down and they make sajda. Go down on your hands first. So the camels, they go down. So they made noise. So the Prophet didn't want to hear that unnecessary noise during the prayer. Run into the masjid. That's unnecessary noise. So he stopped the people. So noise during the prayer that's unnecessary should be eliminated. So we want to speak about two people. The one person who doing his adhkar and ruku and he's saying Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, and he's going and some people do it in a very annoying way. The way they snap their lips, it is annoying. He's of the opinion that he has to read Surah Al-Fatiha, for an example. So after the Imam reads, he reads Surah Al-Fatiha, and the person who is right in his left in front, they can hear him. We say, there is that position that you have to read Surah Al-Fatiha, but where did it say you had to read it out like that? So listen, Ikhwani, you may be one of those people and you don't realize it. When you're praying next to the person and you're making adhkar and you're in ruku and sajda, you may be one of those people who are making that noise with your lips, and that is annoying. Annoying. Anybody who feels that that's not annoying, it's not. Put your hands up if you feel it's not annoying. Put your hands up if you pray next to people like that and it is annoying. Put your hands up. By unanimous decision. Although I think some of you are from those people though. So pay attention, because some of you may be from those people. So when you pray, don't do that thing. And don't make that noise. Don't come into the masjid running. That noise is also under this hukum. And then we have the thing where the people will come and the imam is about to pray, or the people, they're in the prayer and he gets in the line and he says, نويتُ أن أصلي صلاة الظهر من خلف هذا الإمام مقتدي به مستقبل القبلة في هذا يوم الجمعة هذا. And he goes on and on, and the people are praying and they say, wait, what's up, man? What are you doing? That is tashwish, and it's not from the religion. It's not from the religion. If that was from the religion, we will find a hadith coming to tell us that. And if reading Salat Surah Al-Fatiha out loud like that was from the religion, we would have had a hadith like that. We don't even have a hadith that says some of the companions used to read Al-Fatiha, and we heard them. And so we don't have that. We have the general hadith of the Nabi, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that you should read Surah Al-Fatiha. But we don't have this thing where people were reading and people can hear them reading. So be cognizant of that. And don't be of the people who make that type of a tashwish. From the tashwish are the du'as that people make collectively in the masajid. Alhamdulillah, we don't have this issue. But after the salat is prayed, the people start making community du'a, a communal du'a in jama'at, and people going to pray. The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam prohibited us from reading the Quran out loud while you're sitting and someone is praying. You should read the Quran with a low voice, no tashwish, because the masjid is for everybody. It's just not for the recital of the Quran. Lower your voice and let that man pray and concentrate. And that's with the Quran he stopped the people. What about a dua that's a bid'ah? Community dua. After the salat, the imam is saying and the people are saying ameen, and the people are praying the sunnah. So you may not pray in this masjid. You may go to other masjids. Let the one who heard us and witnessed what we said go back and tell the people who didn't hear and they didn't witness in a nice way of giving a dawah ilallah. So that dua also is a tashwish. It's not from the sunnah of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam. Lastly, what we want to mention is the issue of the mu'adhins. We don't have that much here, but some of us come from the Muslim world, yarhamakullah, where the mu'adhins, they make the adhan and people start to pray their sunnahs. And the mu'adhin, he starts to say the salat and the salam on the Nabi and all kind of other innovative issues. It's not in this country, alhamdulillah, for the most part. But in some of the masjids who are Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, some of the masjids that are extreme tasawwuf, after the adhan of the mu'adhin, things are being said that is tashwish on the people who have more right to pray to Allah Azza wa Jal uninterrupted and with the ability to have a tarqiz or concentration. We're going to stop here, inshallah, for today's dars. Inshallah, we have two more dars for this particular issue. We'll take two or three questions from the audience, two or three questions connected to the dars. If you brothers have any, fatafaddal. Akhi, Dawood, tafaddal. Yeah, concerning the people who move a lot in the prayer, that's a big problem as well because it's a distraction. There are some hadith that are fabricated and they're not authentic. If anyone moves more than three times unnecessarily, then his prayer has been invalidated. That's not authentic. You can move in your prayer. Move forward, move back, move to side. You can do that. And if you have to scratch, that's permissible. You have to put your hand in your pocket to turn your phone off, that's permissible. You can stop someone from walking in front of you. You can move in your prayer. But to move unnecessarily, with that there's no dalil upon, then that should be avoided. After the imam says, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, and you came late, you move up to take a sutra for no reason. Clearly no one's going to go in front of you where you're at. Why are you moving like that? Where's the dalil of what you're doing at that time? So to move too much, scratching, yawning, moving around, the Prophet says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, inna fi salati la shughla. Verily, the prayer itself makes you preoccupied. So I'm preoccupied, you're preoccupied. We don't need to be more occupied by someone who's moving around. And from this ruling as well, our children who don't know what they're doing in the prayer. And the child is in the line moving around. He doesn't even have a prayer. You're guilty of splitting the saf. Whoever brings the saf together, Allah will bring his affairs together. Whoever divides the saf, Allah will divide your role, your life, your issues. So he puts between himself and another brother, another lady, a child who's moving around. The prayer of that child doesn't count. And you disturb the person next to you. And this is what I mean, ikhwani, by the level and position of concentration about praying in the masjid and coming to the masjid that the Salaf had, that it's just business as usual with the people. How can you not be bothered by, I can't just get in the middle row with this kid. I came to the Saf, okay, it's dangerous. If I leave the kid back there by himself, he goes out of the Islam didn't tell you to do that. It's irresponsible. But you have to come up with the next best scenario. Go all the way to the end. And you start off the new Saf and put the kid on the end. Sit him close to you. If you came last and you know there's no more people coming in that masjid, you know that. Put him behind you. And try to keep an eye on him. Ask for bring him in the Saf, put him back. This is normal in this masjid. And what the kid looked like. She's a little girl. 5, 6, 7 years old. She's a girl. It makes it worse. Let the girl sit back there. She's old enough. She's in the Saf between the men. Akhi, Abu Isa. Who else had his hand up? If a person arrives late to the prayer and the Saf is full and he's going to be the first prayer, the first one to pray, he can get anywhere where he wants to get, the right, the middle, or the left. Because that happened with the companions as the two imams, Abdul Razak al-San'ani and Abu Bakr ibn Abi Shayba, brought in their two books, Kitab al-Musannaf. What did the companions do? They put that book together to show what the companions did. It's not so much what the Prophet did, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but those books to let us know what did the companions do. So when they used to start the prayer, they got on the right, the middle, and the left. But the vast majority of them used to get on the right, and they would start it from the right or from the middle. And that's because the proofs that show, as we mentioned, Aisha said he used to like the right in all of his affairs. Combing his hair, putting his shoe on, and then a tahur, anything that's zina, anything that's khair, start from the right. And they would start from the right. And then some would start in the middle because there's proof for that. وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةٍ وَسَطَى لِتَكُونُوا شُهَدَى عَلَى النَّاسِ وَيَكُونَ الرَّسُولُ عَلَيْكُمْ شَهِيدًا. We made you an ummah that's in the middle. In the middle. The Sirat al-Mustaqim. اِهْدِينَا Sirat al-Mustaqim. Islam wants the people to be in the middle. So you get in the middle. But if you started over here and you came in and he's on the left, the one who did it, there's no sin. And the ones who followed him, no, that's what you should do. Don't he start on the left and you go on the other side. Starting on the right or the middle. You come in, you see the guy in the line, you get with that individual. Tafaddal ya. If a person prays and he didn't know about a dead person being buried in a masjid, then there's nothing on him. لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. But if he knows that there's a dead person in that masjid, then he can't pray. وإن المساجد لله فلا تدعوا مع الله أحدا. The masjid, they're solely, exclusively for Allah. Don't make dua to other than Allah in the masjid. Don't make shirk. Calling on the dead person or having him in the masjid. So the prayer shouldn't be done. If he didn't know about it, Allah doesn't hold him for what he doesn't know. Tafaddal ya akhi. Now there is an authentic hadith that the Prophet says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لو يعلم الناس ما في النداء والصف الأول ثم لم يجدوا إلا يستهموا عليه لاستهموا. If the people only knew the virtues and the rewards of what is in calling the adhan and in praying in the first row, if they only had the choice or the ability to choose lots who's going to do it, then they should do so. Another hadith said, if they were to know and they only could come crawling, then they should come crawling to the first row or to make the adhan. So does that hadith go against the people who The hadith said, let the intelligent ones and the older ones be behind me. There's no conflict between those two hadith. Ubay ibn Ka'b, may Allah be pleased with him, he came to the masjid late and he went to the first row and he pulled a man out of the row and he got into his place in the first row. After the salat, Ubay ibn Ka'b said to that young man, it may be, O son of my brother, my nephew, it may be that you're upset with me, but I heard the Prophet tell us, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, let those be behind me who are ulul ahlam wa nuha, the people who are intelligent, the hufaz of the Quran, and the elders, who, when the imam loses his wudu, if something happens, those people know what to do. So if the ignorant person who had ikhlas made it to the first row because of those hadith, he made it, and he's right behind the imam, and something happens. The imam loses his wudu, and he looks, and then he wants to pull that ignorant person forward. And the ignorant person says, what are you doing, imam? What are you doing? I'm not going to go up there. And then the people in the row is become folder, confusion. Islam is not like that. So if the elders and the ulama come late, those people in the first row, he says to them, you go there. Because whoever leaves something for Allah, Allah gives him what is better. And he got his niyyah. You go there. But obviously, they should try to come on time and stuff like that. But the people in the first row who beat them there, part of their fiqh is, these people should be here. So I'm going to back up. I'm going to take a step in the sunnah and back up and give them that position. And I'll get more reward. I get the reward of praying there and what I just did. Fadl ya akhi. And you had the same question, both of you. Any more questions, ikhwani? Tfaddal, tfaddal, tfaddal. Ay, tfaddal. Certainly the two rakat when entering into the masjid, if a person prays those are the two rakat of entering to the masjid. That's what they are. If he has time to do the next two of the sunnah, then that's something else. Then that's something else. And he should remember the hadith, anyone who prays 12 rakat in one day, then he will get a house built for him in the Jannah. So the more he prays, the better, inshallah. Honey, we don't want to make this darus about the ahkam of prayer. It's about the ahkam of the masjid. If a person comes into the masjid and he's praying in the jama'ah, should we wait for the imam to say Allahu Akbar? And then we say Allahu Akbar? Or should we wait until he takes his position? The companions, radwanullahi alayhim, they would not move until the Prophet took his position, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then they would take their position. So when he said Allahu Akbar, that was just a sign he's about to take the position. That was not the sign to move and to say Allahu Akbar. And this discipline, we don't have it in the masajid. We don't have it. So what I try to do, I'm going to go into sajda. I'll go into sajda and almost get there before saying Allahu Akbar. Because I know if I say Allahu Akbar and go down, people are going to be going with me. And that's how it is in the vast majority of the masajid of the Muslims. And what prevents us? What prevents us from just waiting? The imam said, Allahu Akbar, he went down, we just waited, and then we went down. He said, Allahu Akbar from Qiyam, and he went into Rukur, and then we went down into Rukur. Always, those people are racing. La tasbiquni, don't precede me in the Rukur, and in the Sujood, and in the Qiyam, and in the insiraf. He told the people, don't race me, don't race me when it comes to being in rukur. Don't race me when it comes to making sajda. Don't race me when I'm going to get back up. And don't race me at the time of al-insiraf. After, assalamu alaikum rahmatullah, assalamu alaikum rahmatullah, he used to sit. And sometimes we would say, Allahumma أنت السلام ومنك السلام تباركت. He would just say that and get up. So he didn't make the people stay a long time. But he told them, don't get up until I get up. Any more questions, Ikhwani? تفضل يا أخي. Say it one more time for me, Achi.
I went to many masjid. When you came inside the masjid, you were sitting down, they never make sunnah. Or when you make azan, they then said the drink for sunnah.
Now, I got you. In the Pakistani masjids here, the cultural masjids, the brothers who are from Pakistan, from Bangladesh, the Asian masjids, I can't say this is from their madhab, I don't know, but in their masjids, you will find on the day of Jummah, people come into the masjid and they just sit down. And there may be a bayan in English, so they just sit down. They listen to that bayan. And then when the mu'adhin, the imam comes, assalamu alaikum, the imam makes the adhan, and then the people get up and they pray two rakats. All of this is not what is from what the Prophet brought, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Sunan of Imam Abu Dawood, he prohibited us from having al-halaqa before Jummah. You shouldn't have classes before the Jummah. Because the masjid is for the people to come early as possible and to read the Quran and to pray and to make dhikr. It's not for that. So there shouldn't be any halaqa on Friday before the Jummah. So why is that in English and then the khutbah is in Urdu? Just tell the people their religion in English and keep it moving. After that, the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam would have the adhan made away from the minbar. Now we could have taken some time out, Ikhwani, just to show you how al-Islam has disappeared. Masjids have minbars. Masjids have not minbars, but mihrabs. The mihrab, the adhan is given at the minbar. All of these things are in contradiction to what the Sunnah brought to us. And the scholars of Ahlul Hadith said these things shouldn't happen. Don't make the adhan at the minbar. It's an innovation. And whenever they build masjids, wherever we go, there has to be a mihrab. And that's from the Christians, not even from our religion. And if we were to take that wood and the labor that went into that, that could be used for something better. But every masjid has to have it. And in the Muslim world where they have money, this thing can cost $1 million, $100,000, and it has no place in the religion at all. But we're following the ways of the Ahlul Kitab, and we don't even realize it. If in America, in some of these masjids, you're from the board, you're from the shura, and you said, we don't need a minbar, the people will oppose you, although it makes economic sense. Don't get it. But the people say, we must have it. Especially people who look and make decisions based upon culture and based upon what feels good and based upon showing off and what everybody is doing. So that is an innovation of when the imam makes the adhan. Once the muezzin makes the adhan for Jummah, no one should stand up. Because the imam is going to start talking and you have to sit down and listen to the imam. So you shouldn't stand up at that time. تفضل يا أخي. Shouldn't have a what? A grave. Yeah, this is a good question. In the Prophet's Masjid sallallahu alayhi wasallam, there is his grave. And the grave of Abu Bakr and Umar sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Wa radiyallahu anhuma. And those three graves are inside of the masjid, la shakka fi. So what we have to say about that? It's not a complicated issue. When the Prophet died, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was buried in this position right here. His hujurat were at the end of this table. So he was buried in the house of Aisha and his minbar was right here. And this is the end of the masjid. At the Khilaf of Abu Bakr, it remained. At the Khilaf of Umar, he started building the masjid out that way. out that way towards Al-Yemen. Uthman came. He extended it out that way. Ali came. A lot of drama. He didn't do anything to the masjid. Abdullah Ibn Zubair didn't do anything to the masjid. Nobody did anything to the masjid. Then Umar ibn Abdulaziz came. He didn't do anything to the masjid. When Abdul Malik, Marwan ibn Abdul Malik, when he came, he went out that way. And he extended it that way. And it included the Prophet's grave, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But because we have all of those ahadith telling us you should pray in his masjid, ma kana wa ma kana rabbuka nasiya, your Lord wasn't forgetful. Allah knew when he made it haram to pray in a masjid. He made this the second most important masjid in al-Islam. So what are we going to do? Not pray in that masjid anymore because the leader of the Muslims did what he shouldn't have done. And he was killing people if you went against him. So we're going to tell the people, you can't pray in this masjid. So the one who in his local masjid, there's a grave, he says, why don't you tell the people not praying in Medina? We say because they're the fitna of telling people that is a bigger fitna than telling you don't pray in the grave. What human being in his right mind is going to tell the people today, there are three graves in the Prophet's masjid, tell them, we can't pray there anymore. Who's going to say that? Not a single scholar in Islam said that. But many scholars said, you can't pray in masjids that have graves. So when that imam did what he did, it's what the Prophet said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You people are going to have some imams, you're going to hate them, they're going to hate you. He said, pray behind them. Pray behind them, give them their haq, listen to them, don't go against them. Just, if you don't have, fear Allah to the best of your ability. And this is what happened. So we continue to pray in that masjid because all of those texts telling us the significance of that masjid. But I would say, try not to pray behind that grave directly if you can help it. If you can help it. Try not to pray behind that grave. And when you go to visit him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and you see him from this angle or that angle, after you finish and you want to make dua at that time, face the qibla and make dua. Last question. Brother had his hand up. Okay, akhwani, we're going to stop here, inshallah, azawajal. Tomorrow's the dars about some of the issues concerning the qabr, the adab, the na'im, and where the arwah of the amwat, and so forth, so on. Hadha wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina wa ala alihi wa sahabihi ajma'in. Ayyub.